bro, you really got...
Come on, they want...
Hey!
No! So you know, I needed
yeah.
to talk...
Yeah!
That is definitely...
Are Singaporeans ready for more conversation?
Is everyone being heard?
What's it gonna take for government...
And the people...
...to keep on talking and listening?
Tell us what you think. Good evening, I'm Nicholas Wang, and we're coming to you live on another edition of Voices Today. And contrary to what you saw in the opener there, we do talk and, most importantly, listen to one another on this show.
He, my friend, was enjoying himself way too
tremendously.
Much. Hi, I'm Will Xavier, and introducing the gentleman to my left here, who helped out in the Our Singapore conversation and is on board with us as a guest facilitator. Tell us more about yourself, Chun Seng.
Hi, my name is Chun Seng. I run my coach and facilitating practice. I've conducted about 15 OSC sessions, and it's great to be here.
Mm-hmm.
Very
Welcome.
Good to have you. And
Thank
we
you.
Are live, of course, this Thursday night, and we want you to join us in the conversation. As always, call us at 669-11020 if you want to speak to us live on air. You can also tweet us with the hashtag VoicesToday, or you can log on to tdy.sg/VoicesToday and leave your comments online.
Well, after 660 dialogues involving nearly 50,000 participants, the National Conversation has wrapped up with a report summing up the key reflections released last Saturday.
Yeah, and the chance to express their views and concerns on this kind of scale was a first for many Singaporeans, particularly so for some groups who have long been on the fringes of society. The Movement for the Intellectually Disabled of Singapore, of MINDS, was one of more than 40 organisations outside of government which organised their own little SG Conversations sessions. So how useful exactly was this for parents? Let's find out.
Child is now 16 years old. And more than 10 years ago, you know, it's really very difficult to, you know, to get any advice and not to even talk about getting your concerns heard by the government. But the infrastructure is so lagging that time. And the biggest frustration we have is that don't know where to turn to.
There are increasingly more attention by the policymakers on the special needs community. One good example is the Enabling Master Plan. We've been asked by parents and caregivers many times to arrange for them to meet up with the policymakers to share their concerns and perhaps to seek clarifications. So when we heard that the OSC session was possible, we actually jumped on it.
My initial reaction is that, you know, this is the first time and the government has taken a great leap. So I was pretty excited about it because I think that now they are open to hearing our voices, hearing our concerns.
For us parents of special needs kids, and I have a moderately autistic son, living in a meritocratic society that places a strong emphasis on exams. Children like ours who are not doing well at school, so there are insufficient services and support for them. So there's a fundamental injustice that exists right now. I decided to participate in the Singapore Conversation in order to promote a Mother Switch campaign, my endeavor to create a community that will provide affordable, subsidized, and quality programming for individuals with moderate to severe autism. Going into our Singapore Conversation, I wasn't sure what the rest of Singapore thought about special needs issues. Do actually people care? Actually, I was quite surprised by the passion that many people have in making Singapore a better place and say, how can we be more caring to the elderly, to the poor, to people with special needs?
Going forward, I hope the government will continue to engage the special needs community directly instead of going through MINDS only. This will also allow the government to share the thinking behind their policies and decisions.
For me, I'm hoping that our Singapore Conversation isn't just launched as a campaign, an event with much fanfare, and then afterwards nothing happens. I really hope that it translates into action.
I think that it's very important because I think that it's the people, the parents, that feels the most and knows what is needed. If policymakers want to make policies that are effective, certainly, you know, listening from the ground is very important.
I hope that when we are in dialogue, that caregivers are actually treated as experts in our fields, having had to deal with our kids all these years, instead of just treated as, you know, caregivers, because we are not doctors, we don't have credentials, and we're not taken seriously. Well, actually, my fantasy about our community is how when I walk down the street with my autistic son, who is, you know, really tall, he's 17 years old, is that I don't get glares, I don't get fearful glances, and that if any time there's any issue, I need help or something, he's doing something naughty or something, that people are coming up to support me and help me.
MINDS is trying to create a new TDC. It took so long because the funding and all this has been approved, but when they try to go to a HDB void deck, when they go there, the residents reject them. Being a first world nation, what does that mean? It means caring for the weaker. I think that this kind of dialogue is very important to create the awareness so that not just the leaders, but also the nation, you know, is more ready to be a more caring society.
Time now to hear from our callers at Google Hangout. We have Ian Tan, a blogger, parent and OSC participant. Also, Lukshmaya, lawyer and regular letter writer to Today. We have Calvin Cheng, entrepreneur and former nominated MP. And we're also joined on telephone by Faizah Jamal, a council member at the Nature Society. Hi, Faizah. So, Nick, I suppose the biggest question for everyone, now that the OSC is over, what will happen to all that feedback?
That's true. And there have been strong signals this past week that we can expect to hear about a number of policies changes in the next few days or even sooner. For example, healthcare, education, housing. And we understand that these are all going to feature in the National Day rally by Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong this coming Sunday. But let's not preempt all that. Google Hangout, guys, the question we want to kick off tonight is, will this process of engagement taper off, or will it actually gain some steam or gain some momentum after decades of political paternalism? How can the government actually create a greater environment of trust between itself and citizens and convince Singaporeans that it actually values open, sincere, genuine engagement? Guys, what do you think? Ian? Okay, Ian, we have some problem with your audio. They're not picking up on that. Maybe we'll go to Faizah.
Right, let's get Faizah on the phone. Hi, Faizah. As far as you're concerned, how should the government meaningfully engage civil society groups such as yours and vice versa going forward?
I would like to also include civil servants in this engagement because for oftentimes agencies are our first point of contact. And I think there's already been some level of acknowledgement and recognition that civil society play a role as enablers of change. And I think there has to be a bigger acknowledgement and recognition of this because I think it hasn't gone far enough. And once that has got to that stage where we are recognized as such as enablers of positive change, what needs to happen, in my opinion, is for the engagement process to begin really before a major decision or a major policy or a big change to happen, not when it's already decided. I think when that can happen, then that trust can be further enhanced. Otherwise, I see it to be problematic. And that's on the side of the government and the civil service. On the other hand, as far as civil society is concerned, I think we also need to be more creative in the way we language our concerns. Because oftentimes it seems to me that it is not necessarily the message itself, but how it's articulated that makes a big difference.
Right, right. Let me just hold just hold that thought for me, Faizah. Chun Seng, you heard all that on the vice versa that Faizah was referring to. Is there enough traffic moving in that direction?
Well, I think definitely there is a movement towards that conversation, you know. But as Ching mentioned, it's not far enough. I think there's definitely room to grow and to have further conversation, to have that very civil dialogue, which is, I think, something that's very new to us and something that's possible worth exploring further.
What was the sense of the participants in the OSC with regards to this issue?
You know, I think people are so pent up. You know, they come, they want to speak, they want to share. And it's, as a facilitator, it's always a struggle. You have 10 people in the group and wanting to share. So how do we manage the time? And each of them has their own personal view that is very personal to them. No. So I think it's people wanting to share because they've been so pent up all these years. Right. So I think there'll be even greater opportunity if this can happen more, it's greater for the good of Singapore.
Okay. Right.
Maybe a follow-up question for Faizah. You know, as part of the conversation and a dialogue between different parties, not everyone is always going to agree all the time. Not all Singaporeans may agree with the aims of the Nature Society. So do you think trade-offs, compromises, these are going to be part of the course as we go forward?
Well, as far as like Nature Society is concerned, I think we also have to take on the responsibility, and this came about also as a result of our Singapore conversation that we had for the green community, in which one of the things we really want to do is to go beyond that conversation and then take it upon ourselves to do something else. So one of the things we want to do is what we call mainstreaming the environmental concerns so that more and more people are realizing that these are not just things that are an interest group niche, but rather that environment is everybody's concern. Yeah. That would be the challenge. And then we have taken on that responsibility, and we are going to start something soon, you know, to get people together who are not necessarily nature lovers, members of the public, so that the awareness can be enhanced.
Mm. Okay. Let's come back to Kelvin, who is with us as well. You know, that first question we asked, how are we actually going to see the government doing more to convince Singaporeans that they value open and sincere engagement and that this becomes part of the framework going forward?
I think the difficulty is not in consultation. It is actually when consultation ends up with action. That is where the difficulty comes about. Because when it comes into action, when it comes to actual policy, and the government must act, they will realize that Singaporeans do not speak with one voice. There are many individuals with many diverse voices. And once you act, the government has to take into account the majority view.
Hmm.
And some people will be left out of this majority view. And I think that is the biggest challenge when people... voices are not being translated into policy.
Yeah.
How they will then react? Will they say that, hey, you do not listen to me?
Yes. Okay.
Or will they say that, yes, right, you listen to me, but unfortunately, yes, my voice is not part of the majority view and thus yes, not right, being acted.
Right, Calvin. So if the government could have been accused of not consulting the public earlier in the case of, say, Bukit Brown or MDA's rules and release of population white paper, so when is this consultation warranted even before the policy is decided? Anyone?
Yes, I think it was warranted before the policy was decided. But, you know, at the end of the day, if the government decides that it has to act in a certain way and the policy that he has decided to take on is for the benefit of the majority of Singaporeans. And the people they consult, if they have decided that those concerns are minority concerns, then in a democracy, the minority has to accept that the government has to act in the interest of the majority.
Okay. Well, that's an interesting view, and we're going to take a quick break right now, but when we come back, we want to hear from you about this idea of whether every Singaporean is being heard, and possibly this idea of how much consultation is too much. Can we actually have too much before decisions are made? Do tweet us your views if you would like to join us in this debate using the hashtag VoicesToday, or if you want to join in the debate on air, do give us a call as well. We'll see you very shortly.
Today, thanks for joining us again. So the question is, what more needs to be done in order to create the atmosphere at which the engagement, the future engagement, can continue and thrive, creating an atmosphere of trust? Google callers, you're with us. Ian, you want to have a piece of that?
Okay,
creating
can you
trust?
Hear me now?
Yes. Go
okay,
for it.
So when it comes to the environment trust, right, there seems to be a new way of engagement online that a lot of people may not understand. And even those who are online, sometimes like me, I read both traditional media and I look at news online, I read blog posts. So there seems to be very quick reactions to any news that comes up. So when stuff like OSC, right, when it was first announced, you have a lot of people reacting straight away. You know, this is going to be a waste of time. This is just for show. And when the OSC is going on, you have people who, you know, are just quick to criticize or to give their humorous comments. So that needs to change.
How are we going to change that? How is the government going to do something, or how people, what do they need to do to get to a better state?
So I think the first thing is that I think people need to see some change happening first. And sometimes they may not realize it, but I see some change happening. So in the past year, you know, I've written in quite a few letters to Today newspaper, talking about the education system, about the whole PSLE situation that my children face. My children are both in primary school. So, you know, for a long time, I didn't receive any reply from the government. You know, I'll be writing in one letter after the other. And, you know, you think that, hey, nothing is going on. But a lot of this surfaced at the OSC meeting, which I attended, where Mr. Heng Swee Keat helped to chair the session. So they were listening, and they were ready to think about new ways of looking at the education system. So the very fact that they listen and they're willing to talk about it means that that's one important first step. So the next step that we need to see, which will be announced this Sunday when the PM speaks to during his National Day rally, the actual changes itself.
Right.
So once the first step of listening happens, some change is implemented, and I think opinion will begin to shift towards what this whole conversation is about.
Okay, let's jump to Luk Chung Meyer now. We were talking a little bit earlier, and you said that you're not wired, you're not part of this online generation. Referring to our topic tonight, Today reader Jace Loy says it's not actually a question of whether citizens are ready to have more say in policymaking, but of how high the barrier to participation in a conversation and how open is the government to this. So in your opinion, what shape, form, manner, frequency should future public engagement take?
First, before I actually answer the question, I think this word engagement that the government has with its people can be looked at in two perspectives. The word that has been used even in this program is consultation. Now, it gives an impression that the government of the day has to consult the people before it makes any sort of changes or even laws. Well, I prefer it to be a feedback. I think an effective government must have its finger on the pulse bit. And to get that, the government must be having this continuous feedback from its people.
Right.
I think that's more palatable in terms of governing a country.
Okay, but so do you think feedback is enough? You know, just people reacting to decisions and giving their ideas or views as feedback. Do you think that's enough?
Well, I don't think the feedback should come just after. I think the Singapore conversation, to me, is a very good start. Mm. We've got this conversation on the national level. Now to answer the question that was put to me, which is that the conversation can continue, but at different levels.
Yeah.
It could be at the community level. So for instance, instead of Singapore conversation, it becomes that particular community's conversation, whichever locality it may be.
Yeah.
It can then be also with the various different groups.
Yeah.
So from there, discussions, sort of a persuasion, hearing different points of view comes through.
The case be made for too much consultation? Is there some paralysis might set in if engagement is there's too much of it?
Exactly. I'm not in favor of consultation per se. I rather have this opportunity for the citizens to be able to give the feedback. And I think what's important is for our leadership to be able to be piped into this feedback avenue, this feedback forum, really.
Yeah, I think the other level another level of differentiation is, you know, our setting expectations. You know, is this a feedback? Is this a consultation? Is this a collaboration? And people coming for this session need to be very clear, why am I there? You know, is it for a feedback session which could be relevant? Or is it a consultation prior to a policy itself? So I think this expectation, people get confused. And a bit clarity on that might be very helpful.
An interesting element to throw into this is raised by Devadas Krishnadas, who's a regular commentator in the Today paper. And he says that it's not just the government per se and the people, but senior civil servants have to be prepared for a certain messiness when it comes to the views that are being shared and feeding into the policy making process. What do you guys think about that? Anybody on Google Hangout?
I absolutely agree with that, because I think as far as the people are concerned, their first contact point would be the civil servants. So the civil servants would have to start thinking out of the box. Rules are there, but it's meant for the benefit of the people at the end of the day and for a better, effective system. So with that, I think the problem, the issue should be analysed with the rules there as just guiding points.
Right. I want to bring Jake Goh into the... I just wanted to bring Jake Goh into the conversation. Jake, hi, you're a principal at a kindergarten. Would you like to have a piece of this? Is every Singaporean being heard? And what you had to add to the conversation, do you think you were being recognised and you would be taken seriously?
One thing I learned from the OSC event is that everyone has their own views and perspectives, and everyone thinks that they're right. So it's only when we start to come together and talk about the same issues and hear each other out that we start to understand that there are always two sides of a coin.
Yeah. So specifically, were there, are you speaking about specific groups? Who did you think were not being heard?
Those that are not being heard are usually the minority group or those that are from the lower income and not they can't really converse in English. Because all those that I attend, the people seem to be more educated.
So do you think that there was a bit of tension between Singaporeans themselves, those who are more vocal and those who are not so vocal? And how do we actually try to balance that out as we go forward?
Yeah, that's the challenge that the government will have when they really bring together people from different views and perspectives. And when they come down to deciding on the policies to actually implement, incorporating all these views, like what the first person has talked about, that some people's views will be left out.
Yeah, okay. Nick, if I may add on to your point, I think all those who come for the OSC, no, not all of them are vocal. Some are very quiet, and as facilitators, we need to invite in to encourage them to speak up. But I think it's they took the first step to come for the invitation for the OSC. So they are the silent majority, but I think there's still part of people that refuse to come in no matter what. These are the people that we need to reach out to.
Okay. Yeah.
We still have a bit more time left. Maybe anybody on Google Hangout would like to jump in and contribute on what we've just talked about.
Well, I think it's understandable if people are pessimistic or not willing to come forward immediately. But if we continue with this process, I think more would come on board, and I think more views, more discussions would only, at the end of the day, you know, become better for the nation.
Lukshmi, I'm going to have to hold you there for a while, but I think just to look at some of the issues, if there's going to be a better trust and engagement between the government and Singaporeans, it sounds like that we still need a certain mindset change on all sides. There has to be a willingness to accept greater messiness on the part of senior civil servants when it comes to decision-making.
Yep.
And between Singaporeans, maybe the vocal guys need to listen to those who are more quiet.
For now, though, that's tonight's live telecast of Voices Today. The conversation isn't over for us here in Studio 4. Chun Seng, Nick and myself will be talking to our callers and taking your comments for the next 20 minutes. You can catch the replay of the entire debate in our one-hour encore telecast this Saturday evening at 5:30 p.m.
And of course, do join us next Thursday for another live discussion. We will see you then. Welcome back to Voices Today. Lukshmi on Google Hangout, you were in the middle of a thought there. Let's carry on with that idea that you were talking about.
Which one is that?
I think we were talking about this idea of civil servants, senior civil servants, having to be prepared for greater messiness in the public sphere when it comes to sharing of views, opinions, feeding into policy making.
Well, I think the real issue is that they need to open up, listen to feedback, understand what could be the issues, so that, you know, it, along the way, things change in a sense, like what you say. It's a two-way, the interaction, the people and those in position. It's got to be a two-way dialogue. Both have got to understand each other's position, and I think that's where it becomes better. It's not just a one-way street.
Okay. This idea of understanding positions, there have been views, people saying that there should be a greater transparency and clarity when it comes to information that's shared across all platforms. Kelvin, do you have any thoughts about that?
Yes, I think that the challenge about transparency would come not with the policies that have taken into account the desires of what the government feels to be the majority, because those people will feel that, the government has hurt me and therefore they're acting on my wishes. I think the challenge comes when the government, and the government needs to do this, they need to justify to those people whose wishes are not taken into account of. The people whose concerns have been rejected. That is the challenge, and the government needs to justify to these people, explain to them why their wishes, why their desires have not.
Okay, let's get back to the question, though. The question was whether or not there's sufficient clarity of information. The Economic Society of Singapore Vice President Yeo Lam Kiong has said that policymaking on key issues is becoming so complex that the government badly needs the expert and stakeholder contributions. A Freedom of Information Act would greatly facilitate this process. What do you guys think about that?
Sorry, what do you mean by having a Freedom of Information Act? How would it affect this process?
Yeah. I think, yeah, they want more data and basically more detailed information so that it can then improve the quality of the informed discussion. And academics and civil society can actually play a greater, more contributive role.
Well, I think that there is going to be a limit in the amount of information that the government can share with the populace because, you know, is freedom going to be complete freedom? Are you going to share everything? Because there are some things that are confidential, for example, things to do with defense. And those bits of data cannot be shared with the public.
Yeah. But if they
I think when we talk about the Freedom of Information Act, we must understand that yes, there can be more freedom, but it's still going to be proscribed.
Yeah.
There's still going to be limits to that freedom.
Yeah. As the conversation continues forward on the subjects of those ones that came up a lot, the housing, the healthcare, the education. Access to data in the tweaking of policy going forward, perhaps access to that sort of information might be useful, don't you think, Maya?
Yes, I think it would be. But another way of getting this information is also having more people participate. It's just not conversations, but citizens taking an active role in giving feedback, whether via email, Facebook, whatever, right? So that at the end of the day, I feel it's important that the pulse beat is taken by the government. And for them to be able to do that, the citizenry have got to play an active role. It's a two-way thing. Because quite often we hear the government must do this, the government must do that. But I think we as citizens also play a very important part in, as you say, as a stakeholder of this country, making it better for our grandchildren, for instance.
Yeah. Ian, you had something interesting to say about the tone as well as the quality of the conversation, and you were making the point a while ago about people, you know, shedding their anonymity to make what you described as less colourful comments and yet not making too much sense. Was more or less what you were saying?
Yeah, so just following up from what the rest of the guys said, I think there's actually a lot of information out there, but people need to know or to be motivated to look for the information. If we expect the government to just hand us one big dossier full of information, you know, that's already in the public space, that's wasting the time. People need to do their homework before they come out and say something which they feel needs to be changed. Yeah. And I feel that's not happening enough. So, for example, in the education space, what is very obvious is that, all parents know the amount of homework that the children would have. And they interact with the school, they interact with the kids. Yeah. This is a lot of information that the parent holds. What they need to do is compare notes, have a good conversation amongst themselves first, and then present the case rather than just shooting off the hips.
My daughter is doing my PSLE right now, and she's complaining that her PE lessons are being cancelled, you know, for revision for PSLE. You know, I think this is really stories that we need to share. And parents need to come together. I think that voice is much greater than any data.
But what is great, this is to you, Chun Seng, and anybody on Google Hangout as well. What is going to motivate people to want to do that, to do what Ian was saying, which is to go out there and grab that information and what you were saying, Chun Seng, about people coming together? How do we do that? We know what needs to be done. How do we get people to do that?
I think OSC is a start, you know, to get people to move forward and to speak. It's a lot of time be taken. I think it's a long-drawn process. And we need to win one by one, you know, in season to move forward, to step forward, to share. I think it will work. And I think we need to view this entire conversation as the government is one of the stakeholders. The government is one of the participants in the conversation. It's not about the people versus the government, you know. The government is one of us, and let's have a conversation about that. And if we can bring to that level of conversation, I think that will bring in great results.
Right. We're always happy to have a conversation with Patrick Teo, who joins us by telephone. Hi, Patrick.
Yes, sir.
Patrick is a cabbie, and you've done something very interesting. You've wanted to raise the level of dialogue, and you wanted many people participating. What have you suggested to your passengers?
Oh, my passengers. Normally, you know, we will listen to them, you know. So it's a good way, you know, when the journey, you know, conversation.
Yes.
So we normally will try to listen to them, you know. What is the problem, you know? But sometimes we try to invite them come for the OSC, you know.
Wow.
But it's not that easy.
Yes.
People
why not?
You know, don't trust you because you're just a taxi driver.
Right. Oh, so right. You do a lot of listening, but when you suggest it, well, what kind of reaction did you get?
Suggestion. Sometimes like you talk about the family problem.
Yes.
Some talk about, you know, some is teacher.
Right.
Talk about, you know, so stress, you know.
So when you tell them that they should participate, why tell me about it? Why don't you go and tell them? They're waiting to listen to you. When you tell them that, what do they say?
When I tell them, then they will say, how come this taxi driver, you know, they invite me for this conversation, and you're just a taxi driver. People will trust you or don't trust you, that's another issue, right? But the first part is more important is we listen to them, you know, as a part of our committee, we will try to, you know, bring to the meeting.
Right. They seem quite willing to share their personal lives with you, and they think you're going to listen.
Yeah. But Patrick, you're also a leader with the National Taxi Association, and people say that some of the most vocal critics of the government and its policy are probably taxi drivers. So what does the government have to do to win your trust?
Yeah, we have to let him know, hello?
Yes,
hello?
Yes.
Yeah. We're hearing you, go ahead.
You normally will let the LTA, you know, traffic police know what is our typical. Like, especially, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
For example, like, you know, we what is our feedback is, you know, recently you got this taxi availability for the two indicators. Do you away?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Go on, Patrick.
They set the first indicator for, in the beginning, is 370 kilometers. Right. So we will fight with this government. What is our problem? We can't, you know, achieve this 370 kilometers. So end of the day, you know, they reduce to 250 kilometers.
Mm. So what's your point? Did the government win your trust by doing that? Did they show that they were listening to you?
Yes, they listened to us.
Okay.
That is a very good start, right, with this conversation.
Mm.
So as all people are looking for the first start.
Okay.
Am I right? So now I think government is quite concentrated on this housing, education, right? So try, you know, to achieve the people what they want.
Right.
The first step.
By taking notice of your remarks or your comments or suggestions even, are you happy enough or satisfied enough to keep talking to them if there's more that you'd like to bring to their attention? Do you feel you're being heard, Patrick?
No, I don't think so. They already listened to us so far. Yeah, they listened to us. What is our problem?
Okay.
So they try to like convince, you know, each other, okay? See, where can we change?
Mm.
Where can we change? What can we do?
Yes.
So we'll continue all the meetings, you know.
Yeah.
Like LTA, we have every month, you know, we have a dialogue.
Okay, those are all good ideas, Patrick. But maybe I'm going to open this now and some of these ideas to the guys on Google Hangout or Patrick yourself, if you want to jump in. If the government is going to listen to everybody, as Patrick was saying, was a good first step, it can't act on all the opinions and perspectives and the views and the concerns that they take in. I mean, they've taken in a lot over the course of this OSC. So what is the government going to do then? Anybody on Google Hangout?
Well, if I could try this, they need to have the feedback. That's quite obvious. But I don't think it's fair to have the government make their decision based totally on just the feedback or solely on the feedback. We must understand that they have been elected to office. They are accountable. So at the end of the day, if their policies don't hit with the people, then there could be some consequence during the general election. I think every government is wise to that.
Yes.
So I think that's where I earlier made a distinction between consultation and gathering of feedback. I think for me, they are both very separate and they serve a different purpose at the end of the day.
Right. Yeah, the engagement between citizens also is important. I'd like to take that up.
Yes.
And I want you in on this, Ian. But while I have you, Maya, tell me about the needs of one group of citizens coming possibly into conflict with somebody else's view. So it's one paradigm to be speaking to government. What about speaking to each other?
I think, like what Patrick said earlier, and in fact, the taxi drivers, in fact, this is actually happening. If you go to the coffee shop talk, people are talking to each other, right? It's just that perhaps this is not being carried through, or they are not being too constructive. I think we can all have conversation. But at the end of the day, it's not just highlighting the problem, but perhaps coming up with solutions. I think perhaps that's what the Singapore conversation was different from the other conversations in that sense. Because the feedback was also how things could be dealt with, how things could be solved. And I think that was the positive aspect of things.
Okay, yeah. Maybe I will jump to Ian now. Ian, what about this idea that Singaporeans don't always agree, especially on hot-button issues? Can Singaporeans learn the art of give and take, of compromise going forward?
Okay, so let me bring up the recent case of the girls who shaved their heads at St. Margaret's, okay? So it's a close case for many people, but it was a very good example of how, when the story broke, there was great division in how people viewed the case. Some people sided with the girl, some people sided with the principal, and people were fixed to their beliefs. So I have my own opinions on it, but what was important about the case was that more people needed to speak up. I think that people involved in the case needed to speak up. The people forming their own opinions on should girls be shaving their heads, is it a good thing for girls to be expressing themselves for charity, should the principal, you know, be made those suggestions to the girls. So this may not seem like a big political issue. To me, it was really not a very newsworthy story, but it got blown up proportion. The minister got involved, the newspapers all started writing stories about it. And this was because the conversation got out of hand. There weren't enough people, in my opinion, who were willing to sit down and think through the issue and ask themselves, is this something that we should be spending public bandwidth on?
So I won't ask you too much what your views on shaven heads are. But maybe I'll come to Chun Seng now. And in your experience in almost 15 OSC sessions, how do Singaporeans react when they suddenly realize, hey, I have a view and I'm very passionate about it, but somebody else has a view and may not agree 100% with me? You know, how do people react when they come into that?
Yeah, that's always a paradox that they're facilitated to face. You know, we have people coming in very passionate about certain views, and as you rightly pointed out, they're opposing views. I think in our conversation, we have certain ground rules, for example, of listening with respect. You know, it's perfectly okay to disagree. You know, I can state my point out front, you may disagree with me, but we are perfectly in the conversation. And it was a very civil conversation that we had. But the OSC is a different story.
Right.
So how do you duplicate this in a non-OSC context in the future, where people had a civil discourse, that it's perfectly okay to disagree and still be friends?
That's true. Right. Yeah, so the people who come to the OSC are almost converted already. They're ready to talk.
You know? And also, I think the environment creates such that they are open to talk. They are feel that not being watched. You know, no one censors their conversation. You know, there's no taboo subject. And interestingly, you know, people do bring extreme views in the conversation.
Yeah, disagreement or getting it wrong on something about shaven heads, as opposed to getting education policy wrong, has different consequences, doesn't it?
I think, Luke Shumaya, did you have something to jump in on?
Can I just say that most of the most acrimonious discussions that I come across normally on the internet, it's online. And I think that is the government's greatest challenge at the moment, because there are a lot of very, very acrimonious and very hostile debates and discussions going on online with or without anonymity.
Right.
So I think the challenge, I find that, because I am quite active online as well, both on my own Facebook and blog. Yeah. I find that one way of actually drawing away the most acrimonious part of the debate is actually to ask people out. Yeah. And I think the OSC has shown that when people are human beings face to face, they tend to be more civil. And I think even though the internet is important, the government needs to use internet as only part of its strategy and not its entire strategy. And I hope that it doesn't overreact to the loud, strident voices on the internet.
Okay.
Joining us by telephone is Jean Lee. Jean, if you're hearing us, so you wanted to make a point about what? You can't have too much debate?
Well, one of the points that you were making was that, you know, whether or not the debate or discussion will be overly extended, or, you know, just it will just be too many opinions or too many views. Personally, I feel that it is a journey towards a very balanced discussion. That, you know, right now, maybe there's just too much views, too many opinions on what we want, what we hope to see. I think it stems from the fact that there is not enough two-way conversation going. Because firstly, the policymakers need to be able to demonstrate that they trust the masses enough to explain why they do certain things, so that, you know, there's more education on a two-way street, that people start to understand, and the opinions or expressions that they voice out will be much more, I would say, you know, educated opinion in that sense. So, you know, for now, because there is that lack of two-way, it could be that, you know, there will be a lot of extended discussions, and sometimes it can be very extreme. But, you know, once that growth starts, and, you know, there's more trust between two parties, then the conversation will become more constructive, and, you know, reaches to a point where it will be a truly, I guess, a strong position if the policymakers can tap into the intellectual capital, I would say, of the entire masses. Because, you know, we are no longer a small fishing pot where we rely on a few a few great minds, you know, to run the government. But, you know, now is a great time to really tap into the mass intellectual capital that we have right now.
Okay. As a counterpoint, I remember what Luke Shemeyo was saying earlier about the difference between soliciting feedback and also consultation. But I hear you, and the idea that you can't have too much debate is an interesting one. Anybody on Google Hangout want to share your views on that that idea?
So, you know, I just following on to the caller's point, right? I think the whole idea of a lot of intellectual capital available in Singapore is absolutely true. The question is how to streamline that into sort of a rhythm that we do. So, for example, right, for every major policy, you hear it being argued out in parliament, but you don't hear it being debated between, say, the minister and a group of people in a public forum. Sometimes you have it on Talking Point on Channel News Asia, but I think if the government could look into, you know, setting up such public forums where you have a good sharing of views from both sides to let people understand, and then, you know, chronicle this and publish it. So it's a lot more work, but it does show that there is a willingness not just to talk among each other within the government or within the public space, and then leave the feedback to just emails or forum posts or Facebook posts.
What do the rest of you guys think when it comes to different platforms for this kind of debate? So we talked earlier about a community level kind of town hall. What do you guys think about different platforms going forward?
I think every available platform should be used. Taking on board the various concerns about people not getting carried away too much when they have this conversation. But I think the whole idea is our society seems to be moving. Some many years ago, the people didn't put any expectations on the government in getting feedback or consultation, whatever the word may be. But now we seem to be moving towards a population that seems keen to want to participate.
Okay, they other platforms could be used, do you think?
I think that rather than also just waiting for people to come to the government should also try to go to places where the people are comfortable with.
Like
so,
what?
You know, not everybody is comfortable on the internet, not everybody is comfortable in a formal setting. They could go to coffee shops, to kopitiam, to hawker centers, to places that more reticent people can be drawn out to give feedback as well as consultation to the government. So
I'm sure that happens already, I'm sure that happens already, so what more?
I think the problem comes when the minister or the MP is followed by a whole entourage of grassroots people. So then you don't have much of a conversation going on, see. So I think the key thing here is how about, you know, just getting people to understand the concept of walking the walk, not just talk the talk. So this is something that needs to be inculcated from a young age. And people who grow up not being able to speak up in class or being afraid to share their views openly, this will continue into their adulthood.
Jean, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, actually, that was a great point that I wanted to bring up, that, you know, it should be an ecosystem of a, you know, continuous discussion. I mean, like, if we're using the MPs, the minister going around, I mean, it's a great idea, and theoretically it would work, but realistically, we'll be using up resources of such valuable time and money to do that. So, you know, I think one of the great points was, you know, engaging the young, because, like, you know, the young grows into adulthood, right?
Yeah.
So I think from a very young age, I think we need to be taught to, I wouldn't say challenge for the sake of challenge, because that brings about a whole lot of different problems.
Yeah, now, I'm glad you mentioned time, because I'm fresh out of it. This is the, usually the point when I usually wrap up. Thanks, Jay, and thanks, everyone. I usually wrap up around this time, but I think the guest has the honour today. Chun Seng, why don't you do the honours tonight in about 30 seconds or so? What's the bottom line for you?
I think the bottom line is that we must be get ready for a state of messiness. That is no longer black and white, right or wrong, but this state of flux that we need to be ready for. I think we need to be ready to step up and take ownership of our life, our country, and start the conversation. Not wait for the government, but proceed on our own to get it going.
Okay, thank you so much. And thank you to everyone who's joined us on Google Hangout and on the phone as well. And that is it for us tonight. But we do sincerely hope you will keep thinking and talking and having a conversation about the issues that matter. And if there's a topic you'd like to see us tackle on the show, you know, do feel free to go to tdy.sg/voicestoday. Share your views there. You can also email us at voices@mediacorp.com.sg, and we'll definitely see you right here next Thursday at 9 p.m. For the live episode, another thrilling episode of Voices Today.
Three cheers for inclusiveness.
Always. Thank you so much for joining
us. Thanks very much for being here today. Have a very good weekend. We'll see you soon.
Good night.